You're next in line for the official Holiday World Podcast.
Welcome to Holiday World and Splash and Safari.
Dropping in from Santa Claus, Indiana.
Riders will experience swift acceleration, high-speed turns, and sudden stops.
With Park President and CEO, Matt Eckert.
That's a lot of wasted time.
Fourth-generation owners, Lauren Crosby.
We have to laugh through the pain.
And Leah Cook.
The claws come out.
And Director of Communications, Paula Wernie.
I shovel other things, man.
Yes, you do.
Now stow your loose articles, buckle up.
And please keep your hands and legs inside the car at all times.
We are back. Welcome back to the official Holiday World Podcast. This is podcast episode number 056, which is not a speed limit, Matt, is it?
No.
Okay. I thought maybe in your world it was.
No.
But
it's slower than
056. Today is Friday, April 20th, 2018. The title of today's episode is The One with the Controls Freak.
I guess that's me, isn't it?
You. That's Brian Pastor from... Tell me who you're from.
Irvine Andre Engineering.
Irvine Andre Engineering.
Correct.
Which the coaster nerds know who that is. They want your hoodie. We put a picture of you up. We didn't even reveal your face. We just showed the back of your hoodie.
They don't even care who I am. They just want my clothes.
How do I get your hoodie? That's hilarious.
And it's like, so put it on eBay. You could make some good money.
Well, I'm not wearing it out, but it's got some... coaster wear on it already, some oil and some rips from bolts on the track and everything.
It's well used.
Yes.
Very cool. So we are really excited that Brian could take some time.
I'm excited to be here.
To come over here and talk with us. And let's just jump right in. His name is, again, is Brian Pastor. However, some people refer to him as Brain.
Kind of brainy.
It's a compliment, but it's also kind of like, all right.
It's like, thanks for taking the time to spell my name correctly. So, Brian, what is your story? How did you get to where you are today?
Well, I've always loved theme parks and amusement parks, roller coasters and rides and all that. Growing up as a kid in Pennsylvania, my parents always took me to Dorney Park, which was my old home park. Remember going there every summer with mom and dad and my brother, and always loved going there, watching the rides run and being on the rides and all that. So I never really thought of it as being a career when I was growing up. It wasn't until later on in life that I kind of decided that's something I really wanted to pursue. But I went to school for lighting design, actually. I was a big theater guy in high school and college, and I really liked the technical aspects.
Lauren, I did tell him your brother.
Yes.
Yeah. Also.
So I was a lighting design major. I went to North Carolina School of the Arts in Winston-Salem, North Carolina for lighting design. Got my BFA in design and production. And my last 2 years of schooling there, I opted to take a motion control class where I learned the very basics of PLC programming. And you'll hear us say PLC a lot, which for those of you that don't know, it's called a programmable logic controller. And it's basically just an industrial computer that we program that runs all of your rides and keeps them nice and safe. So I took some classes in that while I was in college and really kind of took a liking to it. Didn't think much of it past that until I got to my very first job out of college, which was at Walt Disney World, where I did everything from merchandise and attractions to technical services. And when I was there, I kind of did some shadowing with some of the WDI guys and learned some more about, programmable logic controllers and what they do. And eventually kind of figured out that's kind of really what I wanted to do. So I took some community college classes. I took some classes off while I wasn't working and learned some more about programming PLCs. And finally, after 10 and a half years at Disney, my wife and I, who I met at Walt Disney World, and she's home right now taking care of my kid. So I have to say, hi, Jen. Hi, Stellan.
How old is your child?
He is three, so he is a handful. So my poor wife is juggling two dogs and a three-year-old at home by herself while I get to run around to different parks.
And snowfall, right?
Because you're in Michigan. So she's dealing with snow and ice and two dogs that are nuts and
you
a kid that's even worse.
You do need to sell the hoodie and buy
I need to give her everything that she asks for.
So. And what is your son's name again?
Stellan.
That's awesome. Yeah. I like that.
Thank you. So, hi, guys. Thanks for taking care of the house while I'm gone. So, anyway, back to... oh my gosh, where was I?
Disney World.
Yes. So after 10 and a half years at Disney, that's where I met my wife. She was actually my boss at Disney World.
Wow.
That seems a little,
Yeah. Well, we won't go there because we're in a church. So,
all right. That hasn't stopped all right, us pastor. Before.
So I got offered a job with Cirque du Soleil out in Las Vegas doing automation there, which is the technical term for the people that control all the moving pieces of scenery that go on during the live show.
There's a lot of that.
There is. And especially the show I was on. I don't know if you're familiar with the show Ka, which is at the MGM Grand.
Yes.
It's pretty much 90% automation. Right. So it's the big show to be on out there if you're an automation guy. So I got a job with them, and my wife eventually got a job on the same show, which was nice. She's a special effects technician. So she was shooting off pyro as I was moving big pieces of scenery at the same time. It was really kind of cool because...
How could love not bloom?
I know.
That makes me and Tanya's relationship seem really dull.
So there'd be times like during the show, I was controlling the stage that she was riding on that was also shooting off the pyro that she was firing off. So that was kind of cool. Anyway, so after 8 years, you know, in Vegas doing live entertainment, we both kind of got to the realization we were tired of doing live entertainment because we were always working holidays. We were always working on my birthday, which just happens to be a holiday. So
4th of July, right?
4th of July.
See, I was paying attention yesterday.
That's my sister's birthday.
Yeah. Oh, is it really?
Yeah.
Cool. So was she brought up to reel it to think that all the fireworks were for her?
She did.
Yeah, my parents told me that way too.
Yes. And she's always had the nickname Firecracker too. I don't know if that's...
There you go.
But yeah.
So... I kind of knew I wanted to get back into the theme park gig. And so I kind of started looking up companies that do controls for rides because I wanted to do the programming, but I also wanted to do the theme park part. So I found a company and was kind of, you know, stalking them a little bit, not really stalking, but just finding out more information about them.
Research.
Yes. We'll call it research. And I found Brian Andre was working for this one company. So I kind of messaged them for a little bit and didn't really get much of a response back, a little bit here and there, but nothing overwhelming. And then shortly after that, I happened to check their site again just for fun, and I noticed he wasn't working there anymore. So I did what any reasonable person would do, and I Facebook stalked him and found out, you know, he had formed his own company with his wife at the time. So I was like, okay, I'll send him an email and see what's going on. Wrote to them and said, hey, you know, this is who I am. This is what I do. I'm really interested in working with you. If you ever hire someone, I know you're not hiring now, but do you mind if I send a resume off? And they're like, yeah, sure, send off a resume. So I send it and didn't expect to get much back from them, maybe a 2-sentence email saying, yeah, thanks a lot, whatever, we'll call you when we need you, or, you know, something like that. I think it was the same night I got like a 3-page email back from Ann just saying, oh my gosh, thank you so much. We're glad you're excited. This is what we do. I sent your resume, or I gave Brian your resume, and blah, 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 blah. So we opened up this conversation from there. And we had been chatting back and forth for a long time. Several months, and then I get a message from them saying, hey, we're going to be heading out to Knott's Berry Farm to do a proposal for some controls work out there. Would you want to come with us? And I lived in Las Vegas at the time, so it was only a 4-hour drive. So I'm like, sure, let's go. And I met them down there. And little did I know at the time, that was kind of like a pre-interview. So I walked around with them and interacted with the park staff, and they were watching me, seeing how I interacted with the park staff and what I was doing and what I was looking for. And we had a good conversation there, and we had a nice dinner afterwards. Little did I know that that was also an interview during the dinner time.
Did you really not know?
I didn't. I had no clue. I mean, they were asking me questions about stuff, but I didn't know it was because they were interested in eventually hiring me. I didn't know that at the time. I learned that afterwards. So after dinner on the way home, it was probably midnight, and Brian calls me as I'm about 10 minutes from my house. He calls my phone, and I'm like, what is he doing? I'm about 10 minutes from home. Why is he calling me at midnight? So I answer the phone, and he's like, yeah, I just have a quick question for you. What PLCs do you know how to program? And I'm like, what's he doing? I got this information. It's all on my resume. Why is he asking me this at midnight? So I start listening to all this stuff. And he's like, okay, well, anyway, that was just kind of a BS answer or question anyway. I just want you to know we're going to hire you once we have time. Once we have the spot open, we'd like you to be the first person to work for us. So I'm like over the moon excited. You know, I'm pacing back and forth at home. I'm excited. I'm telling my wife. She's all excited. Well, then now comes the waiting game, because now they have to wait until they have enough business to hire me. So I'm like, okay, that's fine. I can accept that. So it was about 1.5 years.
Oh my gosh.
So I don't blame them for that. I mean, that's just how it goes. But eventually they did get enough business that they were ready to hire me. And this is the funny part
of the
story.
What's the time frame on this? What year would this have been?
This would have been heading into December of 2015.
Okay.
Because it was my son's 1 year birthday party that it happened at. They, I told you this story yesterday, but it was at my son's first birthday party. My whole family's there. My in-laws are there. Everyone's there. We're having a good time. We're about to give him the cake and blah, 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 blah. And Brian, Ann, and I have our own chat on Messenger where we just use to communicate with one another. And here comes this message up on Messenger from Ann, and it's a video. And it says, Brian, make sure you watch this video, but make sure the volume is up. And I'm like, okay. And I look at the thumbnail of the video and it's Anne sitting in a restaurant somewhere and it looks like she's eating something. I'm like, what is this? So I'm not thinking about it because there's 9,000 things going on in the house.
A cake and a kid
and yeah, everyone's there. So I'm like, whatever. So I pull it up real quick. I turn up the volume and it starts playing and it's Anne sitting in a vegan restaurant eating nachos. And I'm like, what is going on? These people are weird. So she's eating nachos. She's like, yeah, these nachos are really good, blah, blah, blah. And she's going on and on. I'm not like half paying attention. And right as my wife walks by me watching this video on my phone, Ann goes, yeah, these nachos are really good, but you need to come up here and try them for yourself because you're hired and you start February 1st. And I was like, I was so taken aback by the whole thing because it was so strange and out of left field that I didn't really comprehend it all. But of course, my wife, because she's awesome and better than me, says...
And your boss for life.
And my boss for a while. She's always been my boss.
Forever.
Yeah. Forever, yeah. She just starts going nuts. She's all excited now. And I'm like, I don't... What happened? I had to replay the video like three times. So amongst all this excitement of my kid's first birthday, I get offered my dream job to work with this company. So...
Wow.
So that's how it started. Yeah.
Wow. I didn't get a video. Well, I don't know that. Well, let's not go there. You're 27 years.
I think we had a carrier pigeon.
Actually, I had a voicemail or a recording on our machine from your grandpa, Bill Cook.
Oh, that's cool. Had to press the button long to listen ago. To it. Yeah. Yeah.
Had the little micro cassette.
Right.
That was quite a while. So, for the uninitiated, let's explain, what does your company do?
So our company provides the control systems for roller coasters and rides, whether it's a brand new ride or if it's something like your situation, it's a ride that needs an upgrade. We provide the electrical control system that controls anything electrical or mechanical that moves on the ride. So any of the brakes that open and close, any of the motors that move the train, any of the sensors that detect where the train is, all that stuff we design and program a system for that runs the ride safely and provides diagnostic information about how well the ride is running. So that's what our company does.
The diagnostic information is so important because it doesn't just say
rides down.
Right.
Rides down.
Figure it out. Exactly what is wrong. So our guys can go find it. And
yes.
So fast. That we're especially excited about that. So you were here last fall?
I was. I came down in November right after you closed. Some of your maintenance team, who are wonderful, by the way, started the process of gutting out the electrical cabinets and replacing it with our updated equipment. So
that's the control.
That's the control cabinets. Yeah.
That you see the ride operator.
Well, that's the operator panel, but underneath the ride or usually near the ride, there's a main cabinet where typically all the wiring comes back to, and that's where the PLC lives. So they were tearing all that apart and putting in the new PLC and redoing the wiring to compensate for the new PLC and getting that sorted out. That way, when I arrived on site at the beginning of November, it was all ready to go and start testing.
Okay.
So that's what I did in November. We got Raven and Legend online and running pretty well before we left for the season. And now that I'm back here, we're finished up Raven. Legend is just about finished, and now we're getting started on Voyage. We couldn't start on Voyage when I arrived in November because you were missing some lumber on the ride. You were doing your retracking. So it was a little hard to test when you don't have 1,200 feet of track there. So
you're deep into Voyage.
Correct.
I know Josh took a picture yesterday of, I guess, the second train for Voyage is now in the plaza.
Yes.
Ready to, when does that go on the track? Do we know?
Hopefully today or tomorrow.
Okay. Because that's part of the testing, right?
Is running two trains.
Having two trains.
We start off
in 2 weeks.
Yes. And you'll be fine. And, so the first thing we do when we start testing the ride is we just use one train. That way, if there's anything that goes horribly wrong, we can't do anything that's going to cause any damage with just one train. The last thing we do is typically add the second or third train if those exist, and that's when the final testing happens, is with both trains on the ride at the same time.
And what are you looking for when you're testing?
we're looking for anything that's not a desired action, I guess you could say. Okay. So we, the testing part is actually what takes up the most of our time. Is 85% of our time on site is the error checking, making sure that the errors are displayed correctly and that when something goes wrong, the correct action happens. So that's what we do for most of the time while we're on site. Once that's squared away, then we can put that second train on because we know if something fails, it's not going to allow the trains to come too close to one another.
And that's the most important
thing. That is the very most important
running
thing.
Running two trains, you always want to make sure you can
they're
stop
separate,
them.
They're separate, yes, and keep them separate. Yep.
And so there are dozens and dozens of sensors.
Yes.
Voyage
alone.
Where are they placed? And, yeah, tell
well,
us about that.
They're placed along the track in areas that we have equipment that we can do something if we detect something is not correct. So along all up and down the lift, you'll see there's about seven pairs of sensors up there. In the brake run, there's a whole bunch of sensors in what we call the block brake, which is about halfway through the ride on Voyage. There's a bunch of sensors there. And then in the station and leading into the station, there's several sensors in there. So we know where the train is, how fast it's going. And there's also sensors on all the brakes to tell us if the brake's open, if the brake's closed. All of that information is fed back to the PLC. And then our program determines, based on what it's seeing out in the field with all those sensors, what actions to take or not to take.
So someone who, maybe a season pass holder who visited sure. last year mm-hmm. a dozen times.
Right.
And they're can't wait to come back again in 2 weeks. Will they notice a difference?
They might. Obviously, we want to make the transition as seamless as possible so the ride still runs the way that it was intended to run. But there are areas that they might notice in better performance, especially like in the brake runs with the faster processors that we're using now. We can do trimming. When we say trimming, we mean slowing the speed of the train down. We can make the trimming more smoother or less aggressive, I should say. So when you're pulling into the brake run, you're not like slamming in your, you know, into the brakes and.
But some people enjoy that, don't they? Are we going to get some of the enthusiasts? I think are going to be.
They do.
It's the best.
Do they enjoy it, or they just think it's nice because it's a trademark of the ride?
I guess we'll find out.
Yes.
We'll get back with you there.
I don't enjoy it. So.
I don't think, I think most people would enjoy that. And I know the maintenance team doesn't like that either because that's quite a bit of wear and tear on the brakes.
That's a lot of wear and tear on the brakes.
We try and spread that wear and tear over all of the brakes so it's not so aggressive on them. So they might notice the braking a little bit smoother. They might also notice that the trains move into the station sooner. While that's something we did on both. Actually, on all three coasters, we advance the train that's waiting in the brakes into the station a little bit sooner as the first train is dispatching to help with throughput. But we still maintain safety there. I mean, obviously, we're not going to let them just pile up on top of each other. So we always try and keep at least one brake between trains. And that's something we did with all three rides. But we allow the trains to advance in sooner so that your throughput is a little bit higher so you can get people through the line a little bit quicker. So they might notice that.
Again, the diagnostic. So if there is a reason that the of course, everybody says, your roller coaster broke. And it's like, there is nothing broken about it. It's the safety sensors doing their job.
Correct.
But they'll be able to use the diagnostic tools to pinpoint where they need to go check.
They have all three rides have a brand new touchscreen interface that will diagnose anything that goes wrong with the ride and tell your maintenance staff exactly where they need to go to remedy the problem. So.
That's really cool.
And resetting the ride should also
be excited about that because there is nothing worse, I would think, than being a maintenance guy and having to
knowing there's a problem and not knowing
and having to walk into the station,
right?
And everybody's staring at you while you're trying to figure out what needs
to be adjusted.
Because
you're the reason it's down,
right? It's like you have done it yourself, and they're waiting. But they usually do get a big cheer when things
once they get it fixed,
right? But then there's always how long is it going to be? How long is it going to be? Right.
And it's like, and I'm not as familiar with the old system as your maintenance staff would be, but I'm hearing that the reset time between faults and getting the ride up and running is a lot quicker than their previous systems, so that's a plus as well.
It was too long, no matter how long it was.
Right.
Yeah. So this is
so
very,
hopefully this should help.
Very exciting. Good. So as part of this, have you gotten to ride our coasters?
I did. I rode Raven and Legend last year when I was here, and I took my first spin on Voyage yesterday.
You did. After we talked then.
It was after we talked.
Tell us your thoughts, because you're kind of an enthusiast yourself.
That is a ride. The retracking is really nice on the last half of the ride. I'm sure your season pass holders and your enthusiasts will really appreciate that. But wow, that's an endurance run there.
Yeah, for sure.
That is a long ride, but it's fun. I mean, there's nothing like that ride in the world. It's pretty amazing. It's pretty amazing.
You're saying you like the lake curve on
Raven? I do. The too. Raven, the lake turn on Raven and all the tunnels on Legend were really cool. And the triple down on Voyage after the block break is...
It's the best.
You have no idea it's coming. Like, right. I was sort of familiar with the layout, but I mean, there's nothing like riding it for the first time.
You're just starting to catch your breath.
Yeah.
And then,
there's that triple down in the tunnels. Just, it was really surprising. It's fun.
It's a whole new adventure after dark, too.
So. Oh, yeah. I can't wait. I know.
Totally different ride.
I know. And just for the record, I wasn't riding for joyriding. I was riding to see how my braking was.
Sure. So.
Of course.
Sure.
I say
it's
that.
Your own diagnostic.
Part of the job. No, but it's true that we do ride our rides on purpose to see how they're performing. You know, like I was telling you yesterday, anyone with any sort of programming experience can go on to a roller coaster and open up all the brakes and run the motors and make the train go around. What we like to do is finesse all of that. You know, how does the train engage on the lift? How is the braking? Does it pull into the station nice and smooth? Or is it herky jerky as it pulls into the station? That's the type of stuff we like to take the extra time to smooth out and make it more of a quality experience than just...
You know. It's really all three of you, Irvine, Andre, are coaster enthusiasts.
Yep.
Unapologetically so.
Well, correct. That's correct.
And so you know what needs to be done.
Exactly. Exactly.
We all appreciate that.
We do.
Cool. Well, thank you.
So I'd like to end with one more question.
Sure.
And that being, I think we have a lot of young listeners who are still in school and saying, yeah, I want that hoodie.
Yeah.
I want to do what Brian does.
Stay in school.
Stay in school.
Take your math classes. When you say you're never going to use that algebra, you are going to use that algebra. Take as many classes as you can. And if you're not in school anymore, do what I did. I went to a community college and saw if they had any PLC classes. I wrote to the college and I just said, hey, I want to just take a PLC programming class. Do you offer that? Can I just take it as someone that wants to learn more? I don't want a credit. I don't want a grade. I'm not looking for a diploma. I just want the knowledge. And nowadays with the internet, I mean, there are a ton of resources online that you can go to learn about PLC programming and electronics and all that. So just search that out. If you have more direct questions, you are more than happy to find us on Facebook. Write to us on Facebook or send us a message. Our boss, my boss, Ann, is one of her main missions is to get students who are interested in working in the industry, jobs in the industry. She wants to send kids that have the passion to work in the industry to go get steered in the right direction to find the companies that might be looking for students or new employees to, you know, she's a big resource to get those kids where they want to go.
And we will put the link to that Facebook page on our blog post.
Absolutely. That would be appreciated.
Blog post about each podcast episode.
Cool.
Well, thank you. Do either of you have any questions or?
I think you covered a lot of information. Oh, that cool.
I have a random question.
Go for it.
How do you feel your background in theater helped you do what you do now?
It didn't at all. It was a complete waste of time. 4 years down the drain. No, it actually taught me a lot of self-discipline and organizational skills and how to be professional and how to stay focused on what the job was with 9,000 things going on around me. So it definitely, I don't discredit or wish I hadn't done the 4 years in theater school that I did because it really prepped me as a student to be focused and professional and organized, and it allows me to do the job I do today. So,
and that there's a lot of behind the scenes work that makes the experience for the,
exactly.
In our case, the guests.
Yeah,
know?
Exactly.
There's a lot of stuff that goes on behind the curtains that they don't know that helps deliver the magic for them.
If I do my job well, no one knows I did my job well.
Right.
So we're going to send you back behind the curtain. Ryan.
Okay.
We open in 2 weeks. We open in 2 weeks.
Yes, the Voyage is awaiting me. I'm sure the trains are being nice and toasty warm now. So
yeah, you were warming them up.
The cold weather has really been a hamper on us this year, getting the rides up and running. So they've covered the train, got water dummies in it, and got heaters going so we can get back there and get some more cycles.
How long will the testing go on?
For a brand new ride, it's usually about 2 weeks. because of all the errors and everything that has to be checked. When we do a controls overhaul, like what we're doing for your rides, it's a lot shorter because one, we know all the hardware already works. We know all the electrical already works. So that cuts our time down tremendously. So with a controls overhaul, like on Raven Legend and Voyage, it can be as short as 5 or 6 days.
Okay, so you'll be with us a couple more days? A
couple more days through the weekend, and I should be out of here by the weekend, have all the rides turned over to you and get your maintenance staff team and them all trained up, get your operations leaders trained up so they know what's going on. But the good thing about us doing all three is that the systems are very similar across all three rides. So once your operations team knows how to operate Raven, they pretty much already know how to operate Legend, which means they also know how to operate Voyage. So that very was handy. Smart on bringing us in on all three like that.
Yeah, you're not the only brain around. Right. Thanks again, Brian. We really
appreciate
it. Oh, no
problem. My pleasure. Cool. Thanks for having me. It was a lot of fun.
We'll check in with you later.
All right, sounds good. Awesome. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Bye.
Okay, and we will move on now to our amusings.
All right.
Had some sad news earlier this week with Henry Landworth's passing.
It was sad.
And that was very sad, 91 years old. For those who aren't familiar with Henry Landworth, and I did check that it's Henry, it's not Henri.
I saw that one because it's spelled with an I, and I'm is he got a French background? I,
and he's from Belgium, so I thought it could have been. But
I bet back home they called him Henri.
Born in Belgium in 1927, and he was the fellow who started Give Kids the World Village, which we'll talk about that in a minute, but I'm going to read this little bit of information. Henry Landworth, he was born in Belgium in 1927. He was imprisoned from age 13 to 18 by the Nazis, who separated him from his twin sister, killed his parents, stripped him of his name, and tattooed him with the number B4343 etched on his left forearm. He was shuttled between labor and death camps. He was at Auschwitz. He was starved, beaten, and left for dead. Quote, I never had any control over my life as a child, he would write in later years. I think that is what inspired me to do what I'm doing today, to thank you for this life I have. He started Give Kids the World in 1986 and opened its initial 35-acre village 3 years later. Since then, the resort has grown to 84 acres with 166 villa-style accommodations. And Matt, you've been there, haven't you?
I have, yeah. So years ago, I'm trying to think how long ago it was, but we have a trade association in the theme park industry called IAPA, the International Association of Amusement Parks and Attractions. And I was on the Human Resources Committee there, and one of my responsibilities was to head up the Ambassador Program. So the Ambassador Program is typically college students who are interested in going into the industry, and they volunteer their time to help out at the expo. And so myself and another colleague from another park was in charge of the Ambassador Program as part of the HR committee. So one of the things we decided to do with this group is kind of a bonding experience and as a way to expose them to Give Kids the World, because it is such a phenomenal and inspirational place, and it does so many great things for children who have terminal illnesses and things that not every little kid has to go through every day. And it tries to kind of give them a sense of this is, you're perfectly fine. And it kind of just, it's just a great place. So we took them there one evening, and it was in November, and they were starting to put all their Christmas decorations up and stuff. So we spent about 4 or 5 hours there one night, helping the kids decorate their villas and helping them decorate the lunchrooms. And we wrapped presents with them, and we spent some time in the kitchen serving food and going around and just sitting down and talking to the kids. And it was probably one of the best times of my life, I think, that I experienced, just because you just see the joy on these kids' faces that are there, and they're just so happy. And it's nice to see, just that little glimmer of happiness in their faces that they might not have otherwise.
And the Give Kids the World Village really came about because Henry Landworth was associated with the Make-A-Wish program, in that he owned some Holiday Inns in the Orlando area. Mm-hmm. And at one point they had scheduled a little girl to be on Make-A-Wish, and they were going to stay at his Holiday Inn. And there were other, I guess, problems getting everything organized with some of the other entities that were going to be involved with the wish. And the little girl passed away. Her name was Amy, and she was 6 years old. And I think that hit him in such a strong way that, we were ready for you. We wanted you to be here, but something got in the way. So he wanted to smooth that way and make sure that that these villas were available. They're all set up so whatever that child needs, whatever, whether it's a disability or an illness, whatever that child needs to be able to have a great week, they're set up to take care of, and there's doctors and nurses on staff. And I know one of the big things too is you can have ice cream for breakfast if you want it. You can have treats. All, and they're there for a full week, I believe.
For a full week. And, you know, again, it wasn't just the kids that you could see that happening. So it was also the parents. I mean, you could just see the parents, how happy they were to see their child happy too, you know, and experiencing something they'd never really experienced before. And, you know, putting myself in their shoes, you know, I have three kids, and I can't even imagine, you know, what they have to go through when they're experiencing that for their child. And so it was just great to see some program or some, you know, in this case, the village, how much they gave back. Like, they just did so much.
And it's great for the siblings too, because absolutely, it's hard on the siblings.
Absolutely.
As well. You know, and back in the 90s, they came to realize that they were doing this wonderful thing for all these tens of thousands of families. And then they were hearing back from the families that it was kind of a hard readjustment to regular life, that they had this magical week going to Disney World and staying at the village. And so they created a program called the World Passport for Kids. And they approached some parks, including Holiday World, about offering free accommodations for them to come to the park within a year. They get a passport when they leave the village, and they have their World Passport for Kids. And virtually they can just show up at our front gate and show the passport, and we will let them in free. And we were a charter member of this extension of Get Kids the World. So I think it means a lot to us too. And we feel very close to Give Kids the World, even though it's all the way over in Orlando, that we can also help support these families and give them some added joy and know that their fun can continue. And so that's great. And we also donate to Give Kids the World. Really, anyone who's listening who is touched, please go to, it's GKTW. It's like, okay, what's the acronym? .org. And donate in memory of Mr. Landworth, or just because you want to help some kids. But we, I know we talk about Hollywood Nights a lot, our special event for enthusiasts. And what do we do to raise money through that, Lauren?
We have an auction. We auction off experiential items as well as physical items. So we'll auction off, say, you get to walk the lift hill of the Voyage. We'll auction that off, and all the proceeds of that we donate to Give Kids the World.
And some of the, I know we kind of keep in a oversized closet odds and ends over the course of your year. Should we save this for the enthusiasts? Sure, why not? So we
kind of that one man's junk is another man's treasure kind of thing.
Yes, things that, you know, we're always having to train new people as they come on board, especially in maintenance. Don't throw anything away, because chances are. And one thing that we heard from Anthony when they were changing out the seat backs on Thunderbird: do you want these seat backs? And it's like, yeah. So we will have those up for auction. So
I forgot about those. Yes.
Yeah. We got
a photo with it.
Yes. Photo of you doing your best Vanna White.
You know, I try.
The seat back. So things like that will be up. And the experiential things are great too. Really.
Yeah. We expanded a few years ago. It used to just be just the physical items, but a few years ago we decided to auction off some experiential items, and it's been a lot of fun.
Those are popular.
Yeah. I mean, I think we have fun, you know, doing them, as well as I think the enthusiasts really love to buy them.
They love the Zen ride. Those are pretty cool.
Plus, we get to send a chunk of cash down to Give Kids the World to help continue
and I just have to plug,
support.
Yes. I follow Give Kids the World on Instagram, and I thoroughly enjoy checking out like what they post every day and their like stories. It's awesome. It's just like a little bit of happiness every day.
It is. It's so, just,
yeah. Oh, we'll have to check that out. Thanks for the plug. Good thinking. So rest in peace, Mr. Landworth. And my goodness, you're reading an article about him, and Give Kids the World is certainly what he's known for, but he did all sorts of other things that was just that somebody could go through the fires of hell and be such a kind person. And his twin sister, they were reunited. They came over to the United States together when they were 20 years old with the proverbial $20 in their pocket. I mean, he's incredibly self-made man. And his sister just passed away last year. So that they lived that long is fantastic after knowing what they went through during the Holocaust. It's just amazing. So rest in peace. Let's talk a little bit about tembo, which is the Swahili word for
elephant.
Elephant. And we have two projects side by side in the water park that really been interesting with the weather that we've been having. But that crew has been phenomenal.
They really have, considering what they've had to do and the amount of time they've had to do it in.
Yes. And we got the first, I was out there. I watched on the webcam.
So that counts.
Yes, I was part of it all. But we got the first slide for Tembo Falls in place last week.
Looks great.
And the second one yesterday. And I believe there's two or three more that are very quickly.
I think our Florida State slide is up now, Lauren.
Yes, explain that, please. The color coding for our eight slides, junior slides.
Well, myself and my brother and my sister were asked to come up with colors for the slides. Well, actually, I believe we were sent a document, and ProSlide had originally just picked colors and then put them on the slides. And we were asked, do you like these or do you want to change them? And so I was like, yeah, we want to change them.
I got my color wheel. Let's go.
I love any chance to change up colors. So sat down and looked at it and was looking at the colors. And I thought, you know what? There's an opportunity here that myself, my brother, and my sister, we could sneak our school colors into these slides and no one would know.
Ooh. The big reveal.
Now they do.
Now they do. So yeah, obviously they're not true, like 100% true to the actual school colors, because we only had so many colors to pick from. But yes, there is a red and yellow slide that is supposed to represent Florida State's garnet and gold for myself. There's a purple and orange slide for William for U of E. And there's
University of Evansville.
Yes, sorry. Yes. And there's a red and white slide for Leah at Indiana University.
Which is what? Cream and crimson.
Yes. So like I said, not quite 100% on the correct shades, but.
You get the idea.
You get the idea.
Yes. What about the other ones?
Those were just fun and we made sure they color coordinated together and there was a story and it wasn't just random colors, but there's no secret meaning behind the other ones.
Okay. So but each slide has a different color or a different color combination.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
So if you're watching your little
one. Each slide is different too. It's a different experience.
That's what's really going to be great, but it'll be fun a little 7-year-old to say, mommy, I'm going to go ride the Florida State slide.
But that would make me so happy.
That's what Sawyer will say one day.
He will. No, he will. Mommy, I'm going to ride the FSU slide.
We've also just released some information about our Platinum Season Pass preview party, which is coming up.
Five times real
that
fast.
That was, even just typing it, it's like, did I get every word?
Platinum Season Pass preview party.
That's right. So if you're a Platinum Season Pass holder or want to be one, head over to the Holo blog on our website, holidayworld.com, and check out what we'll be doing. Lauren, that's one of your projects, isn't it?
Yes. It's a good time to be a Platinum Season Pass holder.
We've done a lot
opinion.
This year to give them a lot of perks.
So. Yeah. Yes. We're pretty pumped about the event. It has a theme. We're calling it Camp Holodog. So I've stopped calling it that long, confusing thing, and I just call it Camp Holodog.
Camp Holodog.
Yep. It's a lot less confusing for me.
That's good.
But yes.
Whatever it takes.
Yeah. Myself and Amanda on my team, we've been working hard. We're really excited about it.
And so if you already have season passes, but they're not platinum, that afternoon you can stop by and upgrade if you want to join us, because, it'll be the first night rides, because it's from 5 to 9 p.m. Central time. So that'll
be the latest we're open for a while.
Yeah. And it's only for Platinum Season Pass holders. Yes. No one else.
Yes.
If you have a regular season pass, I'm very sorry, but you can upgrade it. Yes.
Yes. So we're excited. And we've got everything listed out as far as what rides will be open. Mm-hmm. We'll have some free food sampling going on.
Yes.
We'll have.
I tried some of those again yesterday and we've got some really good food.
It's exciting going into a new season, because there's always some things that are different. But this year we've got a lot of great new things to try, to sample.
There's going to be a prize wheel.
A prize wheel.
We're working on the prizes still.
No new cars.
No.
Not that kind of prize wheel.
Okay.
Okay. But
cool prizes.
You're going to get something.
What kind of, do we know what prizes yet?
Well, for sure, I can tell you that there will be coupons for some free popcorn or free cotton candy. There will be a Holocash voucher and some front of the line passes, as well as that. And the, those items can be used throughout the duration of the summer. They don't,
you, whenever they want to use them, they don't have to use them that night.
No, we actually encourage you not to use them that night.
And the platinum season pass holders also get their platinum cup,
which I saw yesterday recently.
Yeah, we blogged about
them. They're nice.
A week ago. They're really
very nice.
They're not made out of platinum, so let's make that very clear.
One thing I'm excited about for the season pass holders too is we if you go into our shops this year, we've got a lot of new merchandise that's being developed and a lot of new artwork, and it's just a lot of really cool stuff.
A lot of things to, in fact, that's a blog post that I've yet to put together, but just all the new stuff that's.
We have a vintage line coming out. I'm really excited about that.
Yeah, the stuff that's not Tembo.
Great.
You know, what are the things that, let's point out.
Right.
Take a look here, take a look there. And the Tesla charger out in the Legend Lab, but just things that, that people don't necessarily know about because it may not have made the news, but still.
New restaurant down in Splash and Safari that we've redone and repurposed, and it's got a really cool menu, so pretty excited about that too.
Boy, 2 weeks in
2 weeks.
Yay. It's always like, can we have an extra week?
We don't have enough to do in the next 2 weeks.
Pull with somebody to make that happen.
We always do, though.
We always get there. Something else that I know Lauren's been working out is the preparation here for the new shows. What's going on there?
Oh my goodness, what isn't going on?
Right.
But just this week.
A complete facelift this year.
Yes. So just this week, I met up with our carpenter staff to get to work on essentially completely changing our Hoosier Theater. So it's very, very exciting. But our show production company sent over designs, and I guess our team was having a little trouble reading them. So I spent some time Tuesday morning looking over them and reading them. And I, at least prior to this week, was not familiar with, you know, scenic design documents.
But now you are.
Oh, now I'm very familiar with them. I spent some time looking at them, figured everything out. I had to spend some time on the phone with my brother, who helped me figure out the things that I couldn't figure out on my own.
Did you ever dream when you were growing up
and he was your pesky little something.
Brother? Yay, William.
Yeah, so William saved the day. And I, poor guy, because I totally was on the phone with him for probably like 20 minutes, like at least 20 minutes in the office. And then later in the day, I finally got out to the theater. And then I called him like three separate times. Like I couldn't even just call him once and ask him like the things like in
so
a row.
Probably like the phone thing. Oh, it's Lauren again.
Yeah, I'm sure he was. Again. So sorry, William. But yeah, then we got out there and I was able to actually show everyone like, this is exactly like what this means. Like, here's this on the drawing and here's where it is in real life. And yeah. And the stage is going to be huge. It's getting widened and the sides of the theater are getting, or sorry, I should say the sides of the stage are getting closed in. So the sides of the theater will still be open. So if you're sitting watching the show, you'll still be able to see, you know, rides and such happening. But if you are on the stage, you can no longer see out the sides.
No distractions.
No distractions.
No birds flying through the stage.
Well, it's going to enable us to have much more dramatic lighting.
Cool.
Yes.
This is exciting.
It's very exciting.
It's really neat when you change production companies because they just...
It's fresh new ideas.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just turn it all inside out. Ideas.
Yeah. Well, this is going to be great. And those shows open
May 26th.
So Memorial Day weekend is when we can see what it's all about.
But they'll be rehearsing before that. So, I mean,
that's in like a month.
If you're I guess a week or two after we open the season, they'll be in the park and rehearsing. So there's a chance you might see little snippets of stuff. It obviously won't be a finished product, but you might see stuff if you're visiting before we actually open the shows. Yeah,
take a look and watch and see what's going on. Matt, you mentioned a little bit ago about the weather, and Monday we had our monthly town hall meeting with all of our full-time staff, and there was a little treat planned for the end of the... if you want to talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, so I think as our listeners know, we've been really pumped to be bringing Icy back to the park this year, and so we have several IC mix-up. Well, we have one IC mix-up stands and then several other IC machines throughout the park. But we thought as a treat for all of our full-time staff, we would open up our IC mix-up for everyone to come give it a try. Well,
Usually everybody's excited and they're standing in line and can't wait to sample.
Basically, all they had to do was step outside where we were and hold their tongue out, and they got their icy because it was snowing.
It was like blizzard
not
conditions.
Not just snowing, it was snowing. Like, legit snow. Like, at one point, you could look out the window and it was just white. Like, just a sheet of white. And it's like...
That's amazing.
Mother Nature, it is April. Like, what are you doing?
That was April 16th on Monday.
So I was just at that point, I'm like, I give up. I'm not even going to try to predict the weather anymore.
Seriously.
So we went ahead and
I didn't even know it was supposed to snow that day. Like, was it even in the forecast?
No, I don't think so. Or it was one of those 20% chances that you kind of just blow off. But yeah, it went for a couple of hours.
The next day it was like 60.
Yeah. It was nuts. But the previous, Thursday or Friday, Vern, our foods director, had sent me a couple of photos of them installing the mix-it-up machines. And to explain mix-it-up, there are 12 different flavors of icy, and you can take your cup and mix it up if you want to try three flavors kinds. Or four flavors.
It actually inspired me to come up with our pick your number game this week. So.
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
So when we're ready for that, we can tie it into that.
There in just a moment.
But Lauren and I we still were troopers and we still trudged down in the snow.
Yes, as did
we
I.
We still tried our ices.
It was so cold.
It was, but it's still good.
And we did a Facebook Live, which got far too many views. People were very interested. And for me, the funniest part of it is about halfway through, you both were trying flavors. I know, Matt, you tried Big Red. What did you think?
Oh, I love the Big Red. It was awesome.
Yeah, you would not mix it with anything. It's like, no, I got to have
it. That's what everybody kept saying. Mix it with that. I'm like, no. You don't mix Big Red with other things. You just don't do it.
And you don't mess with your bacon.
You don't mess with bacon.
Mess with Big Red.
Sorry, Rents.
We said it.
And Lauren, you tried, what was it, lemonade and blue...
Blue raspberry, as well as I tried Pepsi.
And Michael, like your classic. Husband, he tried, is it sour apple maybe? I know he and Vern tried.
I don't know. I don't remember what he tried, but
I
do know.
I like the grape a lot too. The grape was really good.
I do know that Michael has already said that I believe opening day, he plans on going and buying the cup so he can get refills all summer.
I
think Lori Cotton tried watermelon and lemonade together, and she liked that a lot.
I feel like you could probably do anything a lot lemonade. Of the fruity stuff with lemonade.
But not Big Red. No.
Leave Big Red alone.
Leave it alone.
I guess we'll put a little sign the up red. There.
Do not mix this.
Do not mix this.
I think Vern mixed it with Mountain
Vern
Dew.
Vern did mix it with Mountain Dew, because then he said it was like Mountain Dew Shock or some variation of Mountain Dew.
Yeah, the red
one. While we were doing the Facebook Live, which of course is live, so you can't, I just have to kind of stand there, and we were talking and you guys were sampling.
And they weren't like real glasses either. They were like little shot glasses.
Yeah, they were just little sample cups. Right. They didn't want you overdoing, I guess, the sugar. And when I went back later, I downloaded the footage because I wanted to make a shorter version of the footage of the video for Twitter. And so that's when I really got a look at it. And while you guys are all talking and sampling, in the background comes our attractions team. So led by, but the way they walked in, all I could think of was, remember a year ago, the guy who was being, he was a professor and he was being interviewed by BBC and he was in a bedroom and his daughter came in the room, remember with the elbows marched in. That's who they remember. It was like the three of them came in and they were smiling and they looked right at not the camera, but the phone. And all I could think of was, it's like, where's the one in the...
So they were their own video.
Yeah, they were in the background, but they all looked just like, oh, there it is. Let's go get some. And all I could think, it looked like that so much. And it's like, okay, there's got to be... Rents has got to come scooting in on the little baby seat, and the poor mother comes running in and drags them out. Anyway,
that's my favorite part.
I think everybody probably recognizes that. That was just the 1 year anniversary, and they brought it back again.
Oh my gosh! So funny, but I can't believe it's been a year.
Yeah, it's funny.
Time flies.
Anyway, seriously. So then Mr. Rents, was somebody suggested for him to try the banana flavor?
I did.
Did you set him up? Was that a setup? Because there was a little light on that said, not ready.
Yeah. I knew he'd do it if I pushed him hard enough.
So,
well, you could look at it in like the little window. It was very,
it wasn't completely frozen. It was very liquidy. And I'm like, banana is just an intriguing flavor to me. I think, try it. Why don't you try it and see what it's like?
He did.
It's like, I like bananas. I'm like, well, then try it.
And he did.
And then he did. And he was like, he's like, wait, I wasn't supposed to try this. It says out of order. Like, well, you know.
So
thanks, Rance.
But it was fun to capture on video just a couple of the facial expressions that we the pod squad grew so fond of over
like I love many banana episodes. Flavored things, but I'm still a little iffy about a banana icy. Like, I'm not sure about that.
Just a little tiny bit.
I'm only okay with actual bananas.
See, I love banana milkshakes. Like, that's one of my favorite things.
No.
But not banana.
I mean, I'll do banana pudding. But that's about the only thing.
I like banana pudding.
With bananas. And you can maybe put a banana in a smoothie.
Do you like banana flavored candy?
No, I hate it. Ooh, it's gross.
Yeah. So it's going to be interesting to hear from folks. But the whole idea of icy just went crazy.
I love the consistency of it.
That. And what is the consistency? I didn't get any.
I don't know how to describe it. It's not like a slush or a snow cone. It's kind of like how Dole Whip has its own consistency. Yeah. Like, Dole Whip is its own thing. Icies are kind of their own thing too.
The reaction,
like, I guess foamy is not the right word, but it's
kind of though.
Yeah.
It's like air, like wonderfully flavored air.
Okay. It's more than just air, because it sounds like you're eating nothing.
But the previous week when they were putting the machines in, because it's what, three different machines, and right. They each have four flavors. Yes. And so I posted that, the icy mixing up machines are going in, and Vernon sent me a photo, and I put it on Twitter. Well, our friend Chad Benefield from WBKR Radio
sent us a text.
He embedded the tweet in and made a little blog post out about it and said, Icy's coming to Holiday, you know, all excited.
And we got and a text from him and said, why didn't you invite me?
Apparently, it's like, who knew? I mean, I knew last, you know, Dole Whip was a big deal the other year, but Icy really, maybe more people have had Icy and are nostalgic about it.
It's a very well-known brand, and it's been around for a long time.
Yeah.
So,
but still, they put the blog post on their Facebook page. Again, this is WBKR Radio. And it's had something like 2,400 shares. 2,400.
I believe it.
Icy's coming. It's like, good.
My oldest daughter, wherever we go, if there is an Icy, she has to have an Icy. She has to have one.
That's a, they what are flavor? Really
good. Red. She likes the red.
She likes the red.
Yep.
It's just, so in the midst of all that, when I got back up to my office and was thawing out after the blizzard and the sampling and such, we found out, actually, Lauren's mom, Lori, who had been out of town for a couple of days, came back in town and saw, and I won't say which radio station this was, but one of the local radio stations mistakenly thought this was part of our free unlimited soft drinks lineup, which it is not, but actually turned it into a news story.
That's right.
And put it on their Facebook page and on their website. And I talked to Lori, and that was the first I knew of it. Lori texted me and she said, have you seen this? And it's like, holy smoke. No, I haven't.
Claire sent me a text and said, you're giving ICs away for free. Why? I'm like, no,
what kind of business sense is that?
Why? Like,
no, we're not.
That's what she says. Yeah. Why? Not, that's awesome. Why?
She's my logical
mind, one. Yeah. But, when I saw Lori over in the office this week and I asked her what she goes, yeah, she said, I saw that. And I thought, gee, I know I've been out of town for a couple of days, but I don't think they changed things that much. I guess she got in touch with you.
She called me first. Yeah. She's like, we're giving away ICs. And I'm like, no, I'm like, there's going to be some free icy samples at the Platinum Pass preview party. Right. She's like, this says we're giving away ICs. And I'm like,
oh no. Yeah. So that shot the rest of my afternoons trying to track down. And the thing
it gave you something to do.
Oh yes. Thank goodness. Been so bored lately, but, it turned out that they had made the correction on their website, but it was a new website and it didn't correct it. They thought it would correct it in both places. Anyway, it gets a little technical, but they're very apologetic. And we answered all the questions. I think people would have asked the question anyway, just because they like to always ask if something's free. But no, but they're still reasonably priced.
They are.
And that's on our foods page, holidayworld.com/foods. All our new menus are up. All our new, the gluten-free information and allergen-friendly information is all up on our website if you want to go take a look.
And if you're going to get multiple ICs, you need to buy the yard.
Yes, you do.
Because then the refills are cheaper than buying a new one.
Yes. And the yard is 20 ounces.
You get more. Yeah, so you get a lot more, too.
Yeah.
I guess the regular cup is 16 ounce. We have that.
Oh, okay.
We have that listed on the website because once we ask the question, it's like, let's write it down. Because if one person asks, then 1,000 will ask.
That's
so we've got that. We heard this week from St. Michael Catholic School in Louisville, Kentucky. Hello, my students in second grade were assigned to write about one of their favorite places. These children chose you. Thank you for all you do. You make a difference. So I'm going to hand out and everybody can read one of the letters. Lauren, if you want to go first, they're all very legible. So you're doing a very good job teaching the children to print and to, for the most part, for spelling, but second grade, good for them. Go ahead, Lauren.
So first off, the very top says go Cards and Holiday World.
They got their priorities straight.
It says, dear Holiday World, I think you have the best water slides. Your roller coasters are awesome. I love your pizza and especially your cheese pizza. I love your log water ride too. It has a big drop. It is so fun. I love Holiday World. So fun. Wow. Yay. Awesome. Sincerely, Taylor.
I think they were told they had to fill up the whole page because all three of them are.
I definitely want to read the top of my page.
All right, go ahead. Yeah.
So the letter says, dear Holiday World, I love the Raven. At first, I would not go on the ride because I thought it was too scary. Now I love it. One of my favorite rides is the Mayflower. I love Holiday World because it is so fun. My friends Tessa, Silva, Sam, and Liam all love Holiday World, and so do I. From Emmy. At the top, she has written, the Raven, the Mayflower, the Legend, the Thunderbrug.
Oh.
I think that's Thunderbird. The Wave Pool.
We should save that name, though. That's pretty good.
The Playground.
Thunderbrug.
And the Wart Park.
The Wart Park. Ooh.
I think she meant Water Park.
I hope so.
But it says the Wart Park.
The Wart Park. Oh,
yeah.
Dear. And
I do like Thunderbrug, though.
And who signed yours?
Emmy.
Emmy. Mine is from Mick. Dear Holiday World, you have awesome rides. Only one exclamation point.
I was going to say that in Emmy's too, because she just used one also.
Yeah.
It deserved two.
Right at St. Michael Catholic School in Louisville, Kentucky. You have awesome food. I personally love your roller coasters. They are awesome. Your water park is so cool. Your wave pools have really big waves. The water slides are so fast. And then he even drew a little picture.
Aww.
Cool.
That's his signature at the bottom of the
page.
These
are next recommends.
So these are very adorable. So thank you, Mrs. Widener, for sending us these, and we'll send her a note that we read them.
That's cool.
On our podcast. And speaking of little kids, a photo of a little Matt Eckert was included. He's rolling his eyes.
Yeah.
And they did a profile. The Evansville Living magazine company has Evansville Business magazine, where they do a profile of a CEO every issue. And Matt's article came out this week, so we'll include a link in the blog post, but it includes little Matt. Were you ever Maddie as
no.
a kid? Okay, so little Maddie Eckert sitting on Santa's lap many years ago when we were Santa Claus.
Claire had a comment about that, too. She
of course she did.
Saw it on Facebook. She's like, why did you let Paula have that picture of you as a child? I'm like, well, I've already discussed that with her. She's like, you're dressed like such a dork, Dad. I'm like, that's how grandma dressed me apparently at the time. And she's like, a nice haircut. Like, yeah, I dressed up with Paula too. But
Kevin, what do you mean you dressed it? You just told me you were embarrassed. Like, don't give me a picture.
I know, but that was her point.
It's darling. It's so neat though that you were here as a little boy when we were Santa Claus land.
But I asked you the question, like, how could my mom put me in? It looks like a sweater vest combination of some sort. Like, who would put that on their kid in August?
Was that August?
I don't know.
Well, maybe it was a Christmas time.
Maybe.
I mean, maybe that was your picture with Santa.
Maybe.
It was Santa Jim.
It was Santa Jim. Yeah.
It's a neat picture.
But I'm like, surely that was in the summer. Why would she do that unless she was trying to recreate the whole, hey, it's Christmas time, let's make you miserable on a 90-degree day kind of thing. I don't know. She would do that. My mom would do that. That's something she would do.
A change of clothes for you.
To make it look weather appropriate for the picture.
Well, it's a cute picture, and we'll let the listeners decide.
Yeah.
But I don't know that Lauren has any sympathy for you, because we certainly have pictures of her as a child at the park, and it's just one of those things.
To be fair, my kids do the same thing to me. They look back at pictures of them when they're little and like, why did you have us wear those shoes? Like, they don't match anything. I'm like, mom did that. I didn't have anything to do with that.
Poor mom.
I was not in the clothing department.
That's funny. We are a holiday world and we love holidays. Sunday, April 29th is the discount deadline for our Rock the World.
Ooh, so yeah. You still have time.
Festival. So you still have time to get the best deals that we're going to have out there. Rock the World is in August. And who are our headliners, Miss Lauren?
We have Jenny Owens, 7-time down, We Are Messengers, and For King and Country.
Yes, yes,
that's
yes.
Very exciting. Matt, you're
I love For King and Country. Love them.
Good. What's your favorite?
I don't know that I have a favorite. I just them.
Like it all.
I do. They're, I really do.
They're really awesome in concert.
They're just incredible entertainers, and their vocals are phenomenal. The message that they deliver is great. It's just, they're right up there with Toby Mac for me. I love Toby Mac a lot, too.
It's
going to
be a good show.
Good. Well, Sunday, April 29th, get those tickets.
And buy them now.
Get the best prices. Wait till August, they're full price.
Yep.
Monday, April 30th is our Twitterversary.
Oh.
Is that a word?
It is. Yes.
You just made it up.
You'll get something from Twitter saying happy Twitterversary on your Twitterversary.
What do you get for your Twitterversary?
Just the pride of knowing we were the first park to tweet.
So it's not like a wedding anniversary where each year is something?
No.
No. It's just
no. But 2008, so that'll be 10 years of tweeting. 10 years of tweets from Holiday World.
Take a long time to catch up after 10 years.
Going back, you can't even go back and see. We can request the old ones. Not a whole... Because I went back looking for something once that wasn't that long ago, and it stops after. I don't think it counts the days specifically. I think it counts the tweets, so it'll only let you go back so many.
So I could see all of mine.
Probably.
Oh, probably they're all there. But you can request from Twitter your own tweets, and they'll send you a spreadsheet of all your tweets. But
I'd prefer it that way.
That would be cool.
Yes.
Now I want to tweet a lot just so I can get a spreadsheet.
Just so you get your spreadsheet on your Twitterversary.
That's awesome.
But 2008, I'll never forget when I used to be on, talking about IAPA earlier, and I used to be on the communications committee, and we had gone out for an event, and I was tweeting throughout, and they were all making fun of me because nobody else was doing Twitter yet. And
a trailblazer.
Who's now laughing all, now?
Yeah. Yeah. All these big parks are like, what are you doing? And it's like, but I love
what you should be doing.
Back then, Twitter was called microblogging.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
That was the big thing, is Twitter's a microblog. But it was the old 140 characters. Of course, now they doubled the characters.
And there probably wasn't an app thing there for it either, was it? 10 years ago, was that around?
I think so. I think so.
Okay.
I think so.
But I'm not. But it used to go down a lot. You get the fail whale. And the graphic would come up.
Whale.
It was a little whale. And there was always the little Twitter bird looking sad. But you get the, they were forever because they grew so fast and they just weren't ready for it. So that a lot of times you'd write this perfect tweet of exactly 140 characters and then you click. And
what's the limit now?
Fail whale. Now it's 280.
280.
Yeah. Okay. Which.
You can say a lot more.
I like
that you don't need to say.
I know. I have to keep it, condense it.
Yes.
Keep it tight. All right. Tuesday, May 1st is National Mother Goose Day. And our tie to Mother Goose, of course, is through our old Mother Goose Land Trail, which is where we go with Holidog Express, the little train ride. And we have some fairly ancient Mother Goose statues.
We do.
Representing different nursery rhymes. And do you have a favorite statue, Matt?
You know, my view of the statues has changed over the years. So what was the Freedom Train, now is the Holodeck Express, would take you through Mother Goose Land, and you would tell the nursery rhymes as you took your took our guests throughout. And so, as you know, here at Holiday World, we jump in and do whatever we need to do when we need to do it. That's always been my favorite ride to operate. So I used to help out when things were, you know, tight. So I liked running that ride. So I liked them all. But I think I got a different perspective of it when this should be the Claire show, because she kind of changed my view of all the statues, too, because I remember taking her on it when she was like, I don't know, 4. She had commentary on each one that really wasn't what a 4-year-old would be saying about them. Like when we went by Tom, the Piper's son, stole a pig. And she's like, of all the things he could steal, it would be a pig. Like, why would he do that?
Bacon, baby.
Yeah. Or when we went by Little Miss Muffet, she's like, okay, that's not realistic. Spiders are not that big. So, I mean, she had commentary for each one of them. So
oh my gosh.
Yeah, I have a different view of them now, but it's still fun. It's great. And it's a neat area for kids. But I liked them all.
You like them all. I had a feeling you'd say that.
If I look at the, are we talking about the character? Or are we talking about the statue itself?
The statue itself.
I like the old lady who lived in a shoe display. Yes. That's one of my favorites.
The one we had to go.
That was mine. Yeah.
Mainly because
we had to paint the little diaper on the baby.
Okay, let's explain that. It was when we put in Kitty's tea party, right?
Yeah. So one of the little kids, just his diaper was a little droopy. Low. Yeah. And I mean, you didn't see like his full backside, but
just a little plumber action going on.
Yeah. And we felt we'd be a little more family friendly and cover that up.
Yeah, it was pretty extensive.
There's some kind of
moon.
Like,
it was a moon.
It was a moon. There's some kind of historical connection to that too. I remember learning that in school, like somehow or another, they were saying that was connected to like Queen Catherine, who was married to, I think, King Henry, because she had 8 kids. And so that's kind of, there was some kind of tie to, you know, how when back in the day when married couples would get married and they would tie shoes to the back of their cars.
Okay.
Supposedly there was some old wives tale that there was a connection between shoes and fertility, and she had 8 kids. And so that's why it's the old lady that lived in a shoe with so many kids.
Wow.
Yeah. Interesting.
I don't know why I just now remember that. That
there
just
are
came into my
background
head.
Stories to just about every old nursery rhyme and fairy tale.
So there's some kind of historical lesson there, I think, but it could have been just made up, but I guess that's all of history.
Living in a shoe is kind of doesn't sound.
So that was Claire's comment. Like, who would live in a shoe? Like, really? They don't make shoes that big. That's right. It's a story. It's a fairy tale. Yeah.
Jeez, Claire.
She's always been my literal child.
Yes. Well, I like the Mother Goose statue, which when you go get
like
in line to ride,
yeah.
Hot Dog Express, you may not even notice, but it's actually suspended over the top of the entry area at the Hot Dog Express. I like Mother Goose.
So is there a Father Goose?
Well, presumably so.
Right. Never hear anybody talk about him.
She probably ran him off.
Probably.
Maybe she's a
like
single
that.
Mom.
A single goose. She just talked to the old lady that lived in a shoe.
That's right. Did you know with our Pick Your Price online ticket discounts, you can save up to $20 per general admission ticket and save a little bit more by using the official Holiday World Podcast promo code HOWOPO, which is HOWOPO. Simply go to holidayworld.com/save, drop in HOWOPO, and let the savings begin. It is time for HOWOPO feedback, and we have a lot. So let us jump right. I just kept thinking, okay, I'll cut back. I won't add as much. And then it was like, no, I'll go ahead. And it was quite varied and lots of new names and faces. And again, mostly Twitter. We heard from Zachary Blanton at ZJ Blanton 11. Hey, Holiday World. I think you forgot one of the new icy. Yes, we had quite a few icy comments. You forgot one of the new icy flavors for the HOWOPO podcast team. They need bacon flavor.
No.
Imagine bacon icy.
Can't
I'm sorry.
No. Sorry, Zachary. Probably not going to happen.
I would eat bacon with my Big Red Icy, but not.
Ew, that's worse. No. Actually, I don't know if it's worse. That's probably not worse.
No, it's not worse. My son eats syrup on his bacon, which I think is weird.
That's okay.
It's kind of like the old chocolate covered bacon concept, I guess. But
no, it's kind of like my favorite. I love Smoky Links.
I do too.
With syrup. Smoky Links with syrup.
No.
Oh,
I just like them with like eggs. Like just
no Smoky Links with syrup.
I love Smoky Links. They have different flavors of them too, but I just like the original ones. Yeah.
We also heard from Emily at Gross 19 Inc.
Okay.
Please, all caps, please bring an icy machine to Rockford, Illinois with Big Red flavor. That was just, and I was thinking of responding, well, why don't you just come here, Emily?
You can have all you want all day.
I went ahead and clicked to read her bio. Sometimes you just put your cursor over their name and it pops up and it's interesting. And indeed, her bio says craftaholic, Harley mama, Big Red. So do you have Big Red, Matt, in your bio?
I do not know.
That might be something to consider. And I also looked further, and Big Red is one of the 16 Twitter accounts that follow her. She has 16 followers, and Big Red follows her.
Big Red needs to follow us.
She's that big of a fan.
We brought you to our park, Big Red.
They might follow us. I can look. It's easy enough to find. find out.
Do we follow them?
We have 54,000 followers on Twitter.
Wow.
Which is, yep, one at a time, one at a time. It's a slow build. But Emily, we hope you can come try some Big Red Icy at Holiday World.
It really is good.
I'm not sure Icy's going to. Anyway, you never know. Sometimes we get tagged for whatever reason in a conversation that when I go read the conversation, it's kind of like, well, I'm not sure this was really meant for us. Not exactly a cheese ball, but nonetheless, it started with the lovely fickleness of an April Jess. This is her name on Twitter, at Lady Jess Macbeth, which I enjoyed the Macbeth portion of it. Anyway, her tweet was, I want a hoop skirt. Matt Schaefer responded, then go do it. The lovely fickleness of an April Jess responded, LOL, I'm poor. To which Matt Schaefer at Matt Schaefer 1974 said, so am I. Somehow this West Coaster made it to Holiday World for one day, probably the second best day of my life, next to saying yes to my best friend. So thank you, Matt. I'm glad we could give you the second best day of your life. And the lovely fickleness of an April Jess, I hope you get that hoop skirt. That was right. Matt, doing a silent laugh doesn't work on radio.
Sorry. I can't laugh out loud now because that would be too obvious.
All right. Well, but
I found humor in that.
A hoop skirt.
No, I found humor in her, like her extremely long Twitter handle.
Yes.
That's the longest Twitter handle I think I've ever heard.
Yes. There's a couple of real long ones out there. Most people try to be concise in the spirit.
Is it bad? I don't even know what. I don't even know what my Twitter handle is.
It's Matt Eckert.
Is that what it is?
Yes.
Okay.
You got in early because there are plenty of Matt Eckerts out there, but you got in early and you got it.
It's pretty sad. I didn't even know what it was. Isn't
yes,
it?
It's yes.
I'm all right. Caught up.
Next, we heard from Vuko Wolf at Vucko Wolf 1984, wondering what the title for episode 404 of the podcast will be. To be honest, I'm expecting a pun like episode not found in reference to the infamous error 404 page not found.
We're on 56 now.
I know. Yeah.
I don't know if I'll be walking by the time we get to episode 404.
But thanks for the idea.
Unless we start like skipping numbers.
No, that wouldn't be.
We could start at 400 next time.
No.
Then we might make
it. We should do that just to get to 404.
Yeah. And
then we'll go back.
And then we'll go back.
Okay. Well, we'll consider that. But thank you. Thank you for the idea there, Vuko Wolf. We heard from Ribs and Bacon. It's hashtag National Grilled Cheese Day. Is adding another topping to a grilled cheese sandwich ever acceptable?
Yes.
We should.
Oh, he says, I think not. I'm not a fan of using mayo to grill either.
It works. Okay. I wasn't either because I always thought
this
you
is
were
the most excited that you feel this whole hour.
I love grilled cheese. I always thought you were supposed to use like butter or margarine.
Mayo's better.
But mayo works better.
When it does. I don't burn it.
You don't. I forget who told me that or where I learned about it, but
I learned about it from like a mayonnaise commercial.
It totally works. And you can't taste the mayonnaise.
No.
Like there's no flavor.
It works with the mayonnaise.
On the
like
outside.
On the outside.
Yeah. So
like instead of butter.
It. Instead of butter on the outside to grill it, you use mayonnaise. Totally works.
Do it. I just promise. Do it.
I don't know.
No, you should do
you
it.
You have two reliable sources here. At least one.
Yeah.
I'm pointing to Lauren. Yeah, no, it totally worked. I was, you know, I like to cook too, so I had to try it. Totally worked. I was going to say we should ask Leah. Leah's like the grilled cheese connoisseur. Like,
well, that's... I think toppings on grilled cheese is totally acceptable. There's a chain in this area of the world called Tom and Chi, and it is all about tomato soup and grilled cheeses.
Okay.
And all the grilled cheeses have like all these different toppings on them, and they are amazing.
So have you had tomatoes on grilled cheese before? Because seems like that would be
in there with
combination.
The cheese, or is it on top of the sandwich?
No, it's in there in the sandwich.
Okay.
In the sandwich.
They'll put like chips on it and like meat and they have all kinds of different sandwiches.
Yeah, we make grilled ham and cheese sandwiches at home all the time.
Yeah. But that's not a grilled cheese sandwich with ham. It's a ham and cheese.
Is it or is it not? Could be.
No, it's a grilled ham and cheese sandwich.
Or it could be a grilled cheese with ham.
With mayonnaise. Ew.
You got to try. You can't taste the mayonnaise, I promise.
Okay. This one's really random. Debbie Simpson.
What's not random?
The Holiday Inn Express in Fenton, Missouri is awesome. They always go out. This was to Holiday World. The Holiday Inn Express in Fenton, Missouri is awesome. They always go out of their way to accommodate my allergies.
Well, maybe that's where she stays when she comes to the park.
In Fenton, Missouri?
Maybe.
How far is that?
Not far. I don't know.
Where's Fenton? I don't know where Fenton is.
Probably near St. Louis,
anyway,
I bet.
Anyway, I don't know why.
That's still far.
But it was the day before. Remember, it was Cheese Ball Day last week? It was one day before Cheese Ball Day, so that may have been an early celebratory tweet. And we also, on that same day, heard from Shika Thakur.
It's just 3 hours away.
Okay.
It's in a suburb of St.
Well, there are
Louis.
Closer lodging opportunities.
But maybe she likes
Debbie
to spend
Simpson.
Some time in St. Louis before she
comes. Because they accommodate her allergies. She did spell accommodate correctly, so 2 points for that. Two C's, two M's.
And 3 points for coming to our park from Fenton, Missouri.
But we don't know that she did.
She did. I know she did.
She's talking about the Holiday Inn Express.
I feel it.
So, anyway, Shika Thakur said the five best hashtag destinations to visit in hashtag Portugal. So, yay for us. We're one of the five best destinations to visit in Portugal.
Hey.
I'd like to go to Portugal sometime.
Okay, but we're not located in Portugal,
we're not.
Shika. Oh, anyway, and then the next one, as we continue on our cheese ball theme, there was a video of pigeons eating crumbs next to a hot dog stand.
I already don't like this.
And yeah, I know. I thought of you with the pigeons, so I didn't send it to you. And the tweet was from Iceland Photos at Dorisig. It says, great food for the birds in downtown Reykjavik at the best hot dog shop in Europe.
Hashtag
at Holiday World.
Okay.
So I don't, we're
everywhere.
It's interesting. Yeah, we're in Iceland.
We're global.
Too. We are. We're in Holiday World.
That's right.
Okay, then. So next we go to a familiar name, Chandler Bainter at Bainter Jr.
Yay, Chandler. And
this was in response to a tweet with a Thunderbird in it, a video saying, who's ready to ride? And Chandler's response was me, 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 me. Well, you get the, it was all.
Was there commas after each me?
No, just me, me, okay. Me, me. There were spaces in between the me's and hashtag ho, ho, ho. Well, so Chandler's ready to ride. We get that. Then it says, translate from the Spanish. You know, it gives you the little offer. Do you want to translate? No. So I thought, yeah, okay. So I clicked it and it says, Holiday World, me, me, it, me, you, me.
That's what I would have translated as too.
That was so in the Spanish, that's what it is at our hashtag ho, ho, ho. So thank you, Chandler, for the
and Spanish translator
multilingual tweet. We also heard from Caleb Fry at Caleb Fry 3. So far, I've pre-ordered every new t-shirt design. Can't wait to show them off this summer.
That's what I was saying. We've got some cool stuff coming down the pipeline. It's really awesome.
Yeah, because we had released the Raven shirt, the Voyage shirt, and the Thunderbird shirt. And we have them up for pre-order on the Holoshop, which is available at holidayworld.com. And somebody, it was Brian Lighty on Facebook, had said, what about Legend? Legend's my favorite. And Matt pops on there because I was like, I had not heard that there was one. It did seem weird to skip Legend, but Matt popped on there and chimed in.
It wasn't quite what I wanted for the first few versions. So.
Ah, so we got that released. And yeah, Caleb come back and bought every stinking one of them. So we'll get those.
The Legend ended up being one of my favorite ones.
The Legend is really,
for sure.
Really
yeah.
A great shirt. So it's
I
exciting.
I know I shouldn't say that, but it is.
It's.
I mean, I liked them all, but.
Yeah,
I don't know. There was just something about that one that just was
Raven
really,
design is wonderful.
Raven, the
too.
I like the Voyage one too a lot. That was really cool.
And when we released the Legend design, @TIJJER_, whoever the artist for this is, I applaud them. It looks amazing from colors, composition, lighting, etc.
I would love to say I was the artist, but that would not ever be close to the truth.
It's very, very cool. We heard from Coaster Dean Chauvin, on the verge of getting our season passes. Finally, can't wait. So we'll see a lot of Dean this summer. Because remember when we first met
him. If you upgrade, you can come to Platinum season
pass. That's right.
Yeah.
Really have fun. And may the 4th be with you.
Yes.
Yes.
We can have a ball. But originally when we met Coaster Dean, he was in Texas. But now he's in the Nashville area. So he's just 3 less than 3 hours
away. I love
away.
Nashville. Yeah. So I love Nashville.
Come see us a lot. We also heard from Matt Coons at SN. These are O's. OOC1. And he posted a graphic about the riding coasters' health benefits, which I thought was very. So I'm he's interested. Saying, "Who's ready to start their journey to a healthier lifestyle? I am. So for your body, it improves circulation. I don't know where this list came from, but just for people who need an excuse to go ride more roller coasters to say it's healthy.
Do you ever need an excuse?
Pain and tension relief. Increase immunity, lower blood pressure. That does not lower my blood pressure, I'll tell you that.
Maybe that's why I have such low blood pressure.
Too many coaster rides. Improve motor skills, relieve chronic pain, burn calories, calm nervous system. That does not calm my nervous system. I'm questioning a few of these. Cardiovascular health, lower stress, neutralize anxiety, increase energy. And then for the mind... Mindfulness, increase mental strength, improve concentration, peace of mind, enhance creativity. Do you feel more creative, Lauren, after you've ridden?
I don't know.
Yeah. How about you, Matt?
Never is that creativity that. Supposed to hit you like instantaneously or like just overall develop
probably
your creativity
just
over time?
In the glow of
I definitely feel more energized.
We'll have to pay attention to that.
I've never thought about the creativity side.
So next time we ride a coaster, let's paint something right after just to see how creative we are with it.
Go get icy and paint. Do an icy painting. We have 12 colors.
And if you use 6 of them, you have 924 different combinations.
Yes. Okay. That's your assignment, Matt. Improve memory. So that means you have to remember to do it. Mental awareness, mental clarity, increase self-acceptance. What does that mean? Self-acceptance.
I think somebody's just making stuff up now.
Happier with yourself.
Calm mental chatter.
Okay.
As so opposed voices, to frenzied mental chatter.
The voices in your head. Calm we'll down. Stop. Pass out. Take a nap. I don't know. Balance brain hemispheres and improve brain function.
Interesting.
So, okay.
What wonderful health benefits there are. For riding roller coasters. Thank you, Matt Coons, for that all that information. Sharon Estep yet, or Estep at M, so Ms. Sharon Estep said, thank you, Holiday World, for offering gluten-free choices. Speaking of health benefits, we visit every year and always get pizza, but this year we found out that my daughter cannot have gluten. It'd be a lot easier for her to eat with your gluten-free foods. So that
our gluten-free pizza is really good.
It is. I enjoy it a lot.
I've gotten that before instead of our regular pizza just because I think it is just as good.
Wrestler Mick Foley, retired wrestler Mick Foley, loved it. We took him there last time he visited and he really enjoyed it.
I still ate it last summer even though I could eat the regular pizza.
And
it's good stuff.
Gluten-free funnel cake.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Do other parks have those yet? I know we worked really hard to get ours developed.
We did. We worked very hard.
Also, I haven't heard of any, but
really good.
It is. Like, whenever I tasted it, I couldn't taste a difference.
Yeah.
Tasted just as good.
Glad we could help. And then Ribs and Bacon again just purchased my ticket to Hollywood Nights. Just got real. So he's
that's awesome.
Very excited. So we'll get to meet Ribs and Bacon.
Nice.
I think this is his first visit to the park even.
Is it?
So we'll have to find out. Well, this will be an amazing event. So yay
for
you.
So track us down, Ribs and Bacon.
Of course, we won't know his name because his name tag will have his name on it. So Ribs and Bacon, I guess.
So Ribs and Bacon in parentheses.
Yes. Can we do that on name tags, Lauren?
If someone will tell me his real name, then yes, I could go and edit his lanyard to make sure it says.
Okay, Ribs and Bacon. The way
or he could just take a post-it note on his shirt.
Which will fall off while he's going through the health benefits of riding a roller coaster. It'll fly off into the night. But Ribs and Bacon, if you can direct message me on Twitter so I know it's you, because heaven knows what other people will come up with, what your given name is, and we'll make sure and get that on your name badge, if indeed you want that.
You may want to experience the anonymity.
Yes.
You never know.
I can understand the desire for anonymity.
Me too.
But we did have a question on a forum of Theme Park Review, Rob Alvey's forum. And the question was, let's see if I even included that, but was asking about the ERT, exclusive ride time on the voyage. And during Hollywood Nights, yes, every year we do go ahead and turn off the trim brakes coming out of the spaghetti bowl. And so the question was, are you going to do it again this year? And I said, that's become SOP for Hollywood Nights the past few years, brake-free ERT on voyage. Well, apparently SOP is something that some people know and some people don't know. I just kind of thought standard operating procedure was something that was well known. So sorry for using something that was so... This it was Adam Ico 2 on Theme Park Review apparently went and looked it up, and he said, I'm loving the triple meaning of SOP, which I looked it up too, and indeed there are three definitions for SOP. One is standard operating procedure. Two, a thing given or done as a concession of no great value to appease someone whose main concerns or demands are not being met.
Okay.
And number three, a piece of bread dipped in gravy.
That's what I thought, because that's what my grandpa always did. He would sop up his gravy with bread.
So SOP, a piece of bread dipped in gravy. Yeah, that doesn't make us think of our friends, the coaster enthusiasts. Not one bit. So that really tickled me. We also heard from Smisty at ISMISTY on Twitter, who said, I miss living near Holiday World. Do either of you know who this is? It's an actor and singer, really known more for his being a singer.
Frank Sinatra?
Yeah. Yeah. Great Frank Sinatra gif from, I don't know. And it just said memories on it.
Like the corners of our mind.
That's right. He probably sang that one.
He probably sang everything at one point.
He sang a lot of,
he did.
He sang a lot of stuff. So we miss you too, Smisty. Come see us. We also heard from Coaster Radio. And so, because we gave him a shout out.
This week.
We did. We're almost done. And Coaster Radio was excited because we gave them a shout out because they got mentioned in the last episode.
Said, so now they have again.
Said, hey, yeah, we got a shout out. I need to post a picture of my Kitty Claws plush doing something awkward and maybe we'll get a retweet too. Hashtag ho, ho, ho. I thought, wow, a little shade there.
Yeah,
I don't think crew.
You can't duplicate what the Coaster crew does.
Yeah, my response was, it ain't that easy.
No. So, it's an art form.
It is.
Yes. And I'm sure they meant to put a little winky face emoji on there.
We will pretend the winky face was there.
Yes, we will. Coaster Radio, you stinkers. And New England Coaster Club at Bizarro Fanatic. Holiday World, three more weeks. Are you guys ready?
No.
No.
But we will be.
We have a lot to do.
I will see you opening weekend. Hope crowds are light. Hashtag ho-wo-po. Dang. So that's pretty cool that the New England Coaster Club, I'm pretty sure he said he has a season pass.
Nice.
I just assumed it's cool. A he. It's probably sexist of me, so sorry about that. We also had great fun with the new Lemon Shake-Up building, which, have you seen the paint job on it?
Yes.
It's so
good.
Pretty.
They did such a good job with that. Did you pick out those colors?
It was sent to me for approval. I did not pick out the colors.
It looks great.
And presumably you did approve.
I did approve.
It was very...
It really makes that building pop.
It's a very pretty blue and a very lovely...
Lemony yellow.
Bright... For the lemon shake-ups, which are delicious, freshly made lemonade.
That's going to rival the Dole Whip for me this year because I'm a big lemon shake-up fan too.
Well, fortunately, they're right next to each other, so you can go get one and then go get another, the other.
And then go get an icy.
Yeah. Like smoke.
Sugar overload.
Yeah. We're sloshing around.
I'm going to gain 500 pounds this summer.
So we went ahead and posted the picture of the new look of this building, the Lemon Shake-Up building, and said, does anyone remember what this little building was originally designed for back in 1992? Boy, did we get a lot of responses. We put it on Twitter, we put it on Instagram, we put it on Facebook, and it was a lot of fun because some people were just taking these random guesses. And then a few people got it right. And do you remember the name of what that little building was originally?
Storm and Norman's Tank Tag.
Yes, and Ben Johnson got it right. He tweeted... It's at BW_Johnson, Storm and Norman's Tank Tab, most claustrophobic 5 minutes of my childhood. I love that. And then I responded, and stinky? I seem to remember they weren't well ventilated.
Ooh.
Did you ever go in one of those?
I didn't.
I'm pretty sure I was too short to do it, and they took it out like right before I was tall enough to do it. I believe I was only there 4 or 5 years.
Yeah, I never actually did it either.
Yeah, nor did I.
My cousin did it. I know that, but I didn't ask him how it smelled.
I have to ask him if it was stinky. But it I could see had it to being be. Very, very claustrophobic. Yeah, because how do you ventilate him, and how do you? Anyway, and
probably wouldn't be acceptable today.
No, I know. Sometimes you do. You look back between that and the educated animals, and you think, like, no. "Wow, couldn't?" And somebody said, "Oh, you need to bring those back." And it's like, "Are you crazy?"
Do you think PETA would let us do that?
No, that would be we wouldn't want to do it anyway.
I wouldn't.
Who's going to take care of that chicken?
Not me.
Teach chicken to play the piano.
No.
Jason Woods at Your Pal Jay said, "Isn't that the stand where everyone gets their amusement park rumors?" So I like that one. It's like, no, that's Dippin' Dots. And Adam Gooch at A Gooch 1207 said it was a kissing booth. Alan Haas at Admiral Kirk 1701 height measuring station, which it was for a while. It was for a while. Chrissy Romans at Chrissy Romans Blue Ice Cream. It's like close, kind of the other side. Yep, the other side of the Alamo. And Krista at It's Me, Krista E, to buy ride photos. So, nope. But we could see just by looking at the building without, because we really cropped it pretty closely. So if you didn't recognize the exact building, it could be easy to think it was something else. So we also heard from Mac Kid Evansville at Mac Kid Evansville. This is at Macaroni Kid, which is kind of a kids club, parents club for activities for children. The sun is out today. It makes us even more anxious for opening day at Holiday World. Thank you, Macaroni Kid. And then, did you know it was IU Day? You, probably neither of you care, not being IU. But I bet Miss Leah Cook, working on her master's, knew that it was IU Day. I don't know what that means, other than everybody was supposed to wear red and white and that sort of thing. Well, I saw it trending. We being in Indiana and all, it was trending in our state, IU Day. And so I thought, you know, I've got that photo I took of Mick Foley holding the little IU basketball when he was at the park the last time. So I thought, go ahead and jump in on the trending topic and posted the photo of Mick and said, did you know WWE Hall of Famer Real Mick Foley was born in Bloomington while his dad was working on his doctorate at IU Bloomington? Hashtag IU Day. And we did hear back from several people at IU who apparently didn't know, including IU alumni at IUAA. What? With 3 question marks and 4 exclamation points. So apparently they didn't know. But Mick was born in Bloomington, Indiana, but it was while his dad was taking summer classes. So he didn't stay very long. But if you go back and listen to our first podcast episode we had with Mick, he does talk about that and how he has a great affinity for all things Hoosier, especially us. So that was fun. And I did see that Mick did like the tweet. We go to the Coaster Crew. And I made the photos extra big because the detail in these two is amazing. Scrabble. I will read this to you. I'm pretty sure the official Scrabble dictionary wouldn't approve, but we're playing by our own Holiday World and Splash and Safari themed rules for Scrabble Day. It's all fun and games until someone loses an eye. Get it? Someone loses an eye. They're concentrating.
It's the finger they've given to the foot.
So the foot has a finger?
Yes, the foot has a little
finger on a stick.
It's got a little poker. What I want to know is George. No, not George. Safari Sam. What is in Safari Sam's lap?
I don't know.
He's holding the bag that the letters are in.
Okay.
Oh, there you go. Yep.
We wondered about that this morning. Our Scrabble game from growing up, they hadn't added the bag. It was just the tiles were just loose.
It used to be for a while like this little silver trash bag-like material that the letters were in. I played Scrabble with my mom all the time growing up.
Did you need to study it anymore?
But all the words in the Scrabble game are park related, and Kitty Claus is getting ready to play Ho-Wo-Po.
They're not even just park related. They're all water park.
Watubi, Bihari, Otorongo, Monsoon, and Singa.
Yeah.
Look at Hollow Dog. He's so happy to be playing with his friends.
I bet he's not very good at the game, though.
Big Greenfoot, though, has got it.
My money's on George.
And then you can scoot over to the next one, which says, quote, I'm sorry, Mr. Foote, but if you deduct more than 10% of your income for bacon expenses, you'll need form 1984HW, Pork Worksheet B. I can't depreciate her value, and I have given her credit. She's the best that 5 cents can buy. Hashtag tax day.
Oh, my gosh.
What in the world?
So somebody's got to explain it. Remember, this is radio.
Kitty is not who I would have chosen as my tax accountant of the four, probably. I would have chosen Sam.
I just like that Kitty is like, it's like they're taking a take on a Charlie Brown here.
Right.
Yeah. Right. With the tax advice stand with Kitty in it for tax advice for 5 cents.
And I could see Kitty wanting to make a little money.
So yes. The foot is trying to claim some business expenses, hats for $50, costumes $10, bacon for $250, which is fair. He's not getting any deduction for Big Red. I don't get that.
Or shoes.
Oh, look at the hat. He's wearing a hat.
I know. He looks so business professional.
Clearly, Kitty is not a good tax accountant.
Well, you're only getting 5 cents for the advice.
Yeah, where did you get the hat?
It's a good hat. I like that hat. It's very sporty.
It's almost like plush itself.
It does. It looks like a fuzzy hat. Thank you, Coaster.
Way to go. Awesome. As an accountant, I appreciate that one.
It is pretty amazing. And what was the deal with tax day was already pushed, 2 days late? And they pushed it another day late because their website went down or something.
I didn't hear that.
I guess. It's the IRS.
Yeah. Because I think the 15th was on Sunday. Yes. So they went ahead and moved it to Tuesday was the deadline?
The 17th, right. Yes.
Yeah.
And then they...
Because that's when I mailed my taxes.
As of about, I think, 11 in the morning, they were just getting all these error messages of people would go to file their taxes online. And so at first it was kind of tough luck, but then eventually they were down long enough that they had to say. So I don't know. I don't know if that's they ever came out with, was it just because they were crashed because there were too many people on it? Or
who knows?
But, boy, last minute, Charlie's there. And Lauren's there, but you got in under the line, so that's good. That is good. It's that time again. You've heard the theory.
We already played a game.
We're going to play another game. This is quick and easy. Let's go. You've heard the theory of 6 degrees of separation, right? It's been 25 years since we opened our water park, Splash and Safari, so let's play a game called 25 degrees of separation. Our tax contestants are given... Tax contestants get it? No, they're both... I don't know what they are. Our text, ready to be done.
We don't know
contestants
what we're doing
are given the name of someone or something that is connected with the year 1993. Must figure out the connection to us. Last episode's winner was Matt Ecker.
Of course it was.
You did well. All right, let's hear the sound makers. Yeah.
Let's try this one.
Oh, come on!
My second favorite. Consistent as always.
The squeaky toy. I like to mix things up. I like the icing machines.
Here's our first.
That was bad.
I know.
The Vice President of the United States of America through January 20th, 1993 was Dan Quayle.
Oh, come on!
So Dan Quayle is from Indiana.
Yes, he is.
So, yeah, so he's very tied to the park. And actually, because he's from Indiana and Holiday World and Splash Safari, but I just kind of got a little excited because I found another connection. So when Will passed away, you know, I was going through a lot of his voicemail messages and stuff. He actually had Dan Quayle's number in his Outlook connection. So apparently Will had talked to Dan Quayle at some point.
He visited the park. Oh, I'm sorry.
So when he visited the park, too.
Oh, darn it, I was so...
That's another connection that we have with
Dan
Quayle.
When did he visit the park?
Sometime prior to when he was vice president.
Okay.
Yeah. In 1993. I don't know that part.
Okay, I do. Sorry, Lauren.
I got nothing.
You got nothing?
I got nothing.
Nothing at all. But he visited the park. They came up with some sort of Hoosier History Day or something like that because he was a senator prior to being vice president. And he came down and he spent the day with his family, had a lovely youngish children at the
time.
Did
people know he was here?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like,
and then
the
they went
public
over.
Knew too. Or,
yes. Okay. Yes. And then I think he actually made a speech of some sort at the Hoosier Celebration Theater, and then went and saw Young Abe Lincoln Outdoor Drama at Lincoln Amphitheater that evening, which is where I was working at the time. And I remember right before the show started, he had asked me if he could have a private place to use a telephone, that he needed to get a telephone call. And so I'd given him my office number at the amphitheater, and he did go in and shut the door and used it. And when he came out, they told us that he had to leave at intermission. And that was when they went and that night got on a plane and went down to, I believe it was New Orleans, and he was named vice presidential candidate that week. So that was, I've always assumed that was the call where he found out he was the chosen one to be vice president.
Where is he now? What's he doing now?
Where is he now? I am thinking in Arizona for some reason, but I know he's stays not politically active, but he's been, I think, involved in some think tanks and things like that. And I know he's taken a lot of heat from different little stumbles that he made over the years. But
what politician doesn't?
But it was very impressive when he made his, when he gave up or got up on stage before the show and talked to the audience without notes and was calm and relaxed and interesting and talked about history and the importance of history. And it was really great. And then once they kind of wheeled him out for to be the vice presidential candidate, you could tell he'd been through a lot of training and prep and that sort of thing. And it seemed like a different, he wasn't as relaxed as he was when we saw him on stage at Lincoln Amphitheater. So yes, very good. All right, here's our second one. This time we're going to talk about a pop culture phenomenon introduced in 1993, that being Beanie Babies.
Oh, come on!
Matt?
So Beanie Babies are these little stuffed animals.
Mm-hmm.
We have several costume characters that are animals here at the park as well. So we have big walking Beanie Baby-like characters.
Okay.
Oh, wait, I got another one. So we also have a game called Beanbag Toss. So if we had enough Beanie Babies, we could use those in lieu of the beanbags, since they're animal beanbags.
What I was looking for is we actually did have a little holodog.
Mine wasn't right?
No.
Okay.
We had a little kind of a Beanie Baby knockoff of a little holodog. Do you remember those?
No.
We've got the bigger holodog now, but we used to have a little one. And in fact, the Gravity Group bought one of them and tortured me for a year by sending anonymous emails and photos of this little holodog beanie literally all over the world.
So they were a mean coaster crew.
They were indeed. And which apparently when all was revealed, hilarious. And that this was from leading up to the opening of the voyage in 2006. And I think it was when we had Hollywood Nights 2006 is when they told me, and they actually presented me with a book with all of the emails and all, and we blogged about it. So you can go on the blog and look that up. But it was Holodog's Voyage.
Aww.
And we did, and your dad and I, we tried to figure out who it was. Maybe it's this
one. You didn't even know who it was
from? It was anonymous.
Oh.
I never suspected them. We kept thinking
funny.
Former employee, or we thought it was a coaster enthusiast, or we thought, for some reason, I really thought it was one of the entertainers was doing it, because I think they were in Orlando, and I thought, well, maybe it's somebody that's working down there now. And every time we thought we'd figure it out, we didn't have it. And when they made the big reveal at Hollywood Nights that year, they said it was because I said something, which I don't even remember saying, that engineers aren't creative. So they tormented me for a year.
That was your payback.
But they were really, but we'll go ahead and link to some
That's
of those blog posts.
Hilarious.
Because Holodog went literally all over the world. Had one heck. If he
That's
had
cool.
a bucket list, he crossed just about everything off.
Like Carmen Sandiego.
He was a cute little beanie guy. Congratulations, you've logically controlled your way to the end of another episode.
Wah, wah.
Please join us again in 2 weeks for episode 057. Thank you and welcome back to Stephen Rutherford for making us sound so good. We missed that laugh. Thanks to Josh Moore for the groovy, icy photos showing all 12 photos. He had a real, because it is foamy, you get one filled and then you're ready to take a picture of three of them. And the first one you filled has started to settle a little bit. So he had quite the challenge doing that. But we appreciate you, Ho-Oh-Coco. And thanks to all of you for listening. Please subscribe and leave a review. We have 27 reviews, which I don't know. Is that pathetic? It feels pathetic. It's like,
I have no idea.
Meanwhile, our last episode was the most listened to ever. Over 30,000 listens, which we never set a goal for ourselves is what, at what point we go, yeah,
you
just have no idea.
Oh, you just made me incredibly self-conscious.
Right.
I know. So thank you all for listening. And, you know, if you wouldn't mind leaving us a review or at least go give us a rating 30,000 on iTunes.
Reviews would be impressive, I think.
Well, we got 27, so we're well on our way. We're also
you gotta start somewhere, right?
Spotify, Google Play Music, YouTube, etc. Tell all your friends on behalf of our pod squad, Matt, Mommy Lauren, and back at school Leah, who's very close to graduation with her master's. She's getting close. Thank you so much. And please be sure to send us your feedback and questions on social media using the hashtag HoWoPo.
You've been listening to the official Holiday World Podcast.
Welcome back. Did you enjoy your flight?
A production of Holiday World and Splash and Safari in Santa Claus, Indiana. Check out the latest episodes at holidayworld.com/podcast. Thanks for taking a ride with us.
And please come back to see us again soon.